This is the Shogun Podcast on TV Podcast Industries, and we're talking about Shogun Chapter 5, Broken to the Fist.
He would like to know about a war you have fought in.
My war stories are full of holes.
Please listen. My husband is tired and has had a lot to drink. You must tell him the story. But choose your words carefully.
Welcome back, fellow warriors. This is TV Podcast Industries. This is the Shogun Podcast, and we are talking about Chapter 5 of the first season of Shogun, Broken to the Fist. I am one of your hosts, John.
And I'm your other host, Derek. Welcome back.
Yes, indeed. It is moving on apace now. Mm-hmm. But it's not going quite as, I guess, Toranaga would hope for. Interesting developments here, seemingly going from a place of power to one where he is being undermined by natural forces as much as the machinations of what's going on in Osaka. Really good stuff. But fellow warriors, if you are joining us for the first time, welcome. Mm-hmm. And of course, you can head on over to our website at tvpodcastindustries.com, where you can subscribe to any good or evil podcast player of your choice. We also have our feedback section for each and every episode of Shogun. So if you want to give any thoughts, theories, observations, or comments, or indeed chastise us over our pronunciation of the names, of course, please don't do that. Yep. But please forgive us if you think we aren't pronouncing them right. But yes, you can send in any feedback to our email at feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com, or head on over to our Facebook group where you can leave a message as well on our spoiler-filled posts. Just go to facebook.com/groups/TVPodcastIndustries. Mm-hmm. But I think we should get into our spoiler-filled discussion of Chapter 5 of Shogun, Broken to the Fist. Derek, what are some of the episode details?
Well, of course, the show is based on the James Clavell 1975 novel of the same name, Shogun, and brought to the screen by Rachel Kondo and Justin Marks.
Excellent stuff.
Yeah, this episode was written by Matt Lambert, who's written lots and lots of stuff, but importantly for our podcast, because we always like to call out things that they've done before, Matt Lambert wrote an episode of Season 2 of Invincible.
Excellent stuff.
Guess which one he wrote, John?
I don't know.
He wrote, "In about 6 hours, I'm going to lose my virginity to a fish." The best named episode of Invincible.
Interesting.
Which, interestingly, myself and Chris are also covering on this very podcast right now. So I think this week, actually, we should be starting our coverage of Invincible.
It's amazing the talent and diversity of treatments that writers can get up to. Going from, 16th century or 17th century Japan.
Exactly.
Through to an animated comic book series that's being treated, and certainly one with such irreverence as well.
Both very ultra-violent, I would say, is the big connection between the two.
I guess so, and just the difference in reverence.
Yeah.
Very reverent here in the time of Shogun.
Yes.
But less so.
Very irreverent.
For Invincible.
Particularly that episode. Good stuff. We talked about the director before, Frederick Toye, who directed last week's episode and directed lots of shows that we've covered here on TV Podcast Industries, including The Watchmen.
Yeah, excellent stuff. Yeah. Another great lineup behind the scenes here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. John, do you want to tell us what they gave us with the synopsis for this episode of Shogun, Chapter 5, Broken to the Fist?
Sure. Blackthorne and Mariko struggle to contain the secret that could get them both killed, while Yabushige searches for the spy who has betrayed his intentions to Lord Toranaga. Short and sweet.
It is, as they always are. These are the official synopses from FX and Hulu. Not very representative of the episode either, I think.
Well, there's a lot.
There's a lot happening.
There's a lot happening in this, for sure, and it goes beyond just what the official synopsis happens. Yeah. But certainly, in terms of the personal relationships happening in this wider political conflict, certainly they are two of the main ones. Where does Yabushige lie, you know, in all of this, given his previous associations with Ishido?
Yeah.
And of course, you know, the rules and customs of court being thrown into doubt, and indeed marriage in Japan being thrown into doubt by the arrival of Blackthorne and this relationship that he is cultivating, or both him and Mariko are cultivating.
Yeah, I also think it might be a little simpler than that. I think the people who wrote the synopsis didn't want to reveal that Buntaro is still alive and returns in this episode, because that's a bit of a shocking surprise if you haven't read the books.
Well, indeed.
That he's still alive, because that throws the cat amongst the pigeons for everything that's been happening with Blackthorne and Mariko as well. So I suppose you want to hide that, right?
Yes. And I mean, that is kind of like the opening of this episode.
Exactly.
Is the arrival of Lord Toranaga to Ajiro, and he happens to have this surprise guest with Buntaro still being alive.
Exactly.
Having escaped Osaka.
Yeah, yeah. But one thing, obviously, we want to confirm, we were talking about in the last episode that we weren't 100% sure whether Mariko and John Blackthorne had slept together. After we watched it back again, one more time, thinking pretty clear that that was Mariko and John Blackthorne that had slept together, and she was covering it up the following day, saying a courtesan had been sent over to take care of him.
Yeah, basically. Exactly.
Yeah, but we were kind of going, we're 100% sure. I know John was a little more sure than I was, but it was just the way the scene played out that we just weren't sure when we came to record the podcast. But it was pretty clear the next time we watched it.
Yes, dare I say it, the royal we is being employed here.
It was, yes. Yeah. Yes. Well, when I fail, you fail, John. That's the way I like to say it.
Well, let us get into our top Bushido's for Chapter 5 of Shogun. On to Bushido number 1. It is the fallout of Yozen's murder, the general, Shido's general. And, you know, we have the arrival back of Toranaga. We also have Buntaro joining him. But there is the fallout of the killing and attack on Ishido's representative in General Yozen. I mean, this is kind of interesting, I think, on a number of different levels for me, because I think in particular, just the certainty from Toranaga that his son could not have come up with this idea. You know, and it plays out with the Yabushige as well. And I just really enjoy these scenes, you know, where Toranaga is basically saying, you know, my son is not, you know, Lord Nagakado is not clever enough to think of such a plan. You know, in a sense, Yabushige's game is up. But not in a bad way. It's just Toranaga knows, you know, in a sense that his nephew was at play here. He can see that Yabushige's nephew is actually quite an astute individual. And Toranaga can, it's almost like he kind of understands Yabushige's game, you know, to play both sides. Yeah. He wants that out. And whilst Yabushige almost throws his nephew on me under the bus, you know, do you want him disciplined, effectively, he asks, you know, Toranaga says no, you know, because ultimately his nephew has engineered a situation where, you know, it could force his enemies to attack, to draw them out of the fortress that is Osaka.
Yes.
And then, yeah, I just like the way how Yabushige is, and, you know, I was thinking the same thing, immediately backtracking, immediately trying to kind of save his own neck, really, here. So, you know, this fallout for Yabushige is significant, but also for Lord Nagakado as well, who's reassigned from that cannon regiment, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. He loses the control that he got in the last couple of episodes. So understandable, I guess. But I think you're right. One of the best things about these scenes is that Toranaga, once he is given a moment to just consider what's happening, he's very easily able to put the pieces together. He's like a very good detective in the situation. He's kind of going, okay, my son couldn't possibly do it. Who would be the person that would influence him most? Yeah, that's definitely the right person. But how can I take this to my advantage? Maybe if it draws out Ashida's army, it will actually make it easier for us to win against them, because they won't be able to send their full forces, because their full force has to protect Osaka. So really interesting conversation.
Yeah, absolutely.
There. I also loved his discussion about all men can be broken. I really liked his description of that, where he's saying all men can be broken, just learn to fly them at the right game and they'll sometimes be the ones that will do the hunting for you, which I thought was a really interesting observation from Toranaga as well.
Yeah, I mean, this is where Toranaga's sort of effectively having his annoyed conversation and disciplining his son.
Yes.
And, you know, I just kind of like how, you know, he uses that analogy of falconry. Some are easily attracted to the lure, such as his son. You know, he so easily fell into sort of their trap, you know.
And their bidding, basically.
You know, Yabushige and his eager nephew, they're bidding. And yeah, as you say, then it's, you know, this idea that the falcon has broken to another man's fist, in this case, Nagakado to Yabushige's plans, effectively.
Well, exactly.
And
exactly.
Yeah, really good.
And what Toranaga is saying to him is, if you learn these ways correctly, you could break anybody and make them do your hunting.
Yeah, exactly. So, really good. And Omi is given command of the artillery regiment. You know, there is a part of me here that I feel that Toranaga has some respect here for Yabushige's nephew.
It might be a little bit of keep your friends close and your enemies closer.
I think so as well.
A little bit of that. Yeah.
But, you know, it is kind of interesting. And it's the political game of keeping him close, like you say, by giving him this command. So, again, it's really a good kind of aspect to it. I mean, you know, with Toranaga, he is saying to Yabushige that you must return to Osaka. There has been an order here. And, you know, what are you going to do? So Toranaga is saying you can go to Osaka if you want, but, you know, we've heard from Yabushige about this idea that, you know, he's almost feels, you know, he's got no agency almost. He's trying to find it by doing all these different things. He feels like he's stuck in the middle and none of it is ever going to be sort of fruitful for him in any way. And so
he's trying really hard though. And the point is, you know, he feels like Toranaga's on the precipice here. If he falls, he doesn't want to be the one that falls with him, so he wants to have the backup plan. But the backup plan is regularly becoming the surface plan and getting him into trouble with Toranaga, so he has to reiterate that he is not going back to Osaka because he's fully aligned with Toranaga.
Well, and as he says, you know, from that sunrise scene from the previous episode, you know, since that sunrise, we are bound by fate.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
So I kind of like that. You know, it's that destiny element to it, or that faithfulness. This was really interesting, kind of the fallout from Yozen's murder, effectively.
Absolutely. I also like, and I know you mentioned that his nephew gets the gets control of the cannon regiment, but I do like that Yabushige goes, "It's still my army. You're in control of it. You're my nephew. I'm in control of you, basically."
So. Yeah, exactly. He totally pulls the rug from under his feet.
Yeah.
Doesn't really allow any sense of achievement to sort of wash over him. And interestingly as well, Yozen's head is sent back
in
a box to Osaka, to Ishido. So,
so
with everything going on back in Osaka, there is a timely reminder here with this sort of box being returned. Yes, I mean, you know, ultimately, it's all very Seven going on.
Well, absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely. The head returned to its master.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So well wrapped as well with the cloth or the silks, you know, with no trace of blood on it. So
of course not.
It's all very well packaged.
Well, absolutely. You get the feeling they may have done this a couple of times before, potentially. But do you want to talk a little bit about what's going on in Osaka in this point, or do you want to hold it up for a later point, John?
I think we can hold that on a little bit later for the episode, because we do have a big return here from Edo back to Osaka.
Yeah.
It changes the dynamic here from it just being men talking about how the fate of Japan will go to the insertion of Lady Ochiba as well, as she returns back from being hostage.
Okay, let's hold that for another Bushido. So is there anything else in the fallout of Josen's murder then?
No, not for me. I just think it was really good. You know, it's just the, it's the politics but in this group that's mm-hmm. so interesting here.
Yeah. It was also, I must say, that opening scene when they're picking up the pieces of the bodies and putting them in boxes, basically, it was pretty brutal as well.
Yeah, definitely.
Especially because all the locals in the town are kind of going, we weren't really meant to be doing this. I didn't think this was going to be part of our job. Exactly. So let's go on to Bushido number 2, the other big return for the episode.
Absolutely. Boorish Buntaro mm-hmm. returns and is inserted into John Blackthorne's household. So, I mean, it immediately sort of smacks of pure awkwardness.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, really, really tough. There's some really interesting stuff that's going on as well around it. We get the whole pheasant story, which we'll probably talk about a little bit here, but John being gifted the pheasants from Toranaga's hunting trip. So that must be the most prized pheasant in all of the land, effectively, as he says. So he's going to make something special out of it. He's going to make a stew for everybody.
Well, that's it. And I mean,
his food to the Japanese.
Exactly. I mean, I actually loved this little kind of jokey mm-hmm. through threat, which ultimately had and ended with a serious outcome from it. But I really kind of liked, at least initially, the jokiness of the pheasant, where, you know, it's being, you know, strung up just to mm-hmm. sort of age, is just getting more and more smelly. Flies, you know, and maggots, and everyone in who's not John Blackthorne is kind of like going, we need to get rid of this. What's mm-hmm. he doing? This is like, this is a travesty. What is happening here? You know, and they talk about, I can't remember the name, but almost like, you know, there is a curse upon us. And we have this as well within the conversations between Mariko and Fuji. And I love that perspective of these two talking about how we're both cursed. You know, Fuji goes, I have the barbarian and your husband is back from the dead to Mariko. So, and it kind of plays into this, I guess the pheasant is almost a symbol of that. It's almost like an evil curse on the household. And it's all leading towards this big dinner for Lord Toda, for Buntaro, that John's household is doing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, again, you just have the flies buzzing around mm-hmm. Buntaro, and he's kind of getting more and more agitated by these buzzing flies as he sort of is, you know, like picks them off and kills them.
Yeah.
But you see the irritation from these flies buzzing around him from the sort of decaying pheasant.
Oh, absolutely.
Out front.
But I think that's one of the other really good points here. Mariko is the one that's doing all the translation for John. She understands his language perfectly. She's got really good Portuguese that he's still speaking, right?
Yeah.
So she's able to discuss everything with him, but she might understand the language. But the intention of why you would hang up a perfectly good, freshly hooded pheasant outside to age it is completely lost on her and everybody else in the household. They all believe that something bad's going to happen. And John lays down the line because this is what he wants. This is his big deal. He's actually going to be able to cook for himself and maybe something that tastes like home. So he lays down the line. If anybody touches that, they're dead, right? Just make sure everybody's clear in the household to touch it and you die, basically.
Yeah.
Which I think he means as a little bit of a joke. I don't think he meant it that anybody would die if they take
it
at all, right?
No.
So that's interesting. But also the other element that comes out of this, Buntaro having to live in the household of John, he knows something's going on between Mariko and John. He doesn't like John at all. He doesn't like the grace he's been given by Toranaga.
Yeah.
And interestingly, Fuji feels that John's life is in danger by Buntaro being here as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I mean, it's everything. You know, it goes to the rabbit stew that's being prepared, where it's not to any of their tastes. You know, again, it's all connecting into, well, this is just a barbarian's feast, effectively. And then
I love that he's like, well, I couldn't get all the ingredients that I needed. We weren't able to get any wine, so I had to get some sake into the mix instead of wine. Kind of go, this is not going to taste very good.
No, exactly. But it's like, but it's all gravy in the end.
Exactly.
You know? Yeah. I kind of like that turn of phrase. But
absolutely. And especially because at the end of the meal, Fuji gives the instructions to throw it in the river.
Yeah.
So nobody wants it anymore.
No, exactly. Yeah. And, you know, but it again, it's that back and forth where then all of a sudden, you know, it's almost like John is trying to sort of get into Buntaro's good books by copying him eating the noodles. So you have this noodle eating competition and making the sort of the noise as you take it up. And that kind of morphs ultimately into, you know, as it does between men, I guess.
Some men.
You know, a drinking competition between Buntaro and Blackthorne, with sake being the drink being used here to kind of prove themselves.
Because they effectively come from the standard sake drinking glasses, which are kind of the size of egg cups or shot glasses, basically, to using the bowls for their food and drinking great swaths of this sake, which is massively strong. If you've ever had a sake night and weren't prepared for it, it leads to massive hangovers the next day and very drunken ideas coming out here. Yeah, John does a couple of things to offend Buntaro. Yeah. Initially, welcoming into his home and not calling him Lord Todo went down really badly with him.
Definitely.
Then secondly, the way he eats, as you say, not only is John trying to copy him, that offends Lord Todo, that he wouldn't eat the same way that Japanese people would. And then he asks him to tell him about his great escapades that he's had at war, which again highly offends Buntaro. He's gone through a massive amount of effectively, it's kind of PTSD that they're talking about. He said it took him 20 days to fight his way back to Toranaga's army after the last time they saw him standing on the docks thinking he was facing down death.
Well, that's it. So, it's he asks him about the heroism of escaping Asako, which is not how Buntaro sees it. You know, that was a failure of his duty in some respects to sort of go down fighting. You know, to some extent, it's that, you know, he had to flee to live, you know, rather than face death and maybe come out of that with honor by being kept alive. But I mean, ultimately, it was a no-win situation.
Mm-hmm.
But in the end, you hear from Toranaga that, you know, the number of Ronin helped him, and there were 20 of them. By the end of it, by the time they got back and escaped to Edo, there was him and two of them, you know. So I think it's that kind of, it's that miscalculation from John about fully understanding the rituals and culture that he's in, and he still doesn't. Ultimately.
Yeah, I think Buntaro is also quite an unusual character. He's very different from a lot of the other characters. He is a great warrior, but doesn't see himself as a hero, doesn't want to tell those stories over a pint. You know, he doesn't want to brag about the situations that he's been in. And when John tries to engage him in that conversation, it comes across highly offensive to Buntaro because of what he's done. That's the way it comes across to me anyway. But I get what you mean, that he may have felt he was disrespectful by surviving.
I think it's both. I think it's the manner in which he survived, you know?
But this turns, I suppose, on a dime into some pretty brutal moments here.
Yeah.
We have his demo with a bow, where he effectively shoots out into the garden through the door past Mariko's face with an arrow after drinking a gallon of sake, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
Just that brilliantly caught shot of the arrow going past the face of Mariko. I'm presuming it's CGI. I presume they didn't ask the actress to sit there while they shot a couple of arrows past her. But it looks fantastic.
Yeah, really
just
good
to see it go by her face. You know, he's got that level of Legolas skill with a bow and arrow, really. Buntaro, didn't he?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
But I love, and it's just a touch I noticed the second time I watched the episode. I don't know whether I noticed it the first time, but he shoots two arrows out onto the right post that John has indicated. And later on, when John comes back, you see the two arrows outside, but they don't show you during the moment. They don't show you that those two arrows land exactly where he placed them. They show the arrow going past her face, but they show you at the end of the episode those arrows hit their mark, which I thought was quite interesting. But also then it leads to him instructing Mariko to tell John of her past and who she really is and why he treats her the way he does.
But, well, exactly. And in his
mind, it's okay to do that.
But it's more than that, because, I mean, in a sense, you know, John Blackthorne is kept from exactly what Buntaro is saying to his wife, which is, you know, is in that he's instructing her or forcing her to tell him tell John her sordid history and her filthy line with family line of Lord Akechi Jinsei and his treachery. You know, Buntaro's view is he was treacherous. You know, he calls it a treacherous assassin, killing the former Japanese ruler before the Taiko. And that as a result of this, all her family were killed, and it was her father who had to behead all his family except for her because she had been married to Buntaro.
Exactly.
And after that, has to do seppuku. So, you know, in Mariko's, and we've heard this before, her honor is not served by being kept alive.
Yes.
It's that she wants to end her own life in honor of what happened to the rest of her family. But it is it needs Lord Toda's courtesy and permission for her to do that.
Yeah.
And each year, Buntaro effectively orders her to live, that she cannot do the thing that she wants to do most of all.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's really kind of brutal.
Absolutely.
The whole of this, you know, is brutal. And then you see that, you know, his violence towards her as well, and how that spills out. And so,
but as he's pushing and pushing her to tell this story, he's, you know, not only is she ashamed of the history, because he's made her ashamed of it as well as everybody else. You know, she understood that her father was hunted down and then had to kill her entire family, you know, for what he did. She leaves the table because of her embarrassment. And because of that, then he takes that as a slight and beats her, claiming that it's the sake that made him do it, you know. Hey, I don't feel like this is the first time she's been treated like this by Buntaro, to be honest. I think she was expecting it. But we learn again in the conversation later on with Mariko and John, when he's trying to say to her, you know, don't ever feel bad about this kind of stuff. She's saying to him, I give him nothing. She's showing this is how she employs her eightfold fence. She keeps all of this back. She gives him nothing. She gives him no reaction to all of the treatment that he lays upon her. But quite a major moment. John throws Buntaro out, and Buntaro pleads for forgiveness from John for this. He falls to his knees, apologizing, saying it was the sake.
Yeah, I've disturbed the harmony of your home.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so yeah, exactly. It's all really kind of messed up in a sense,
it is.
Really.
It is, but I really like it, because there's the tendency in these kind of situations, if you're telling the story about, you know, this horrible thing of a husband beating his wife, the tendency would be to have him being really aggressive towards John, not for him to be immediately cowed and apologetic for ruining the honor of the household and ruining the harmony of the household. It's not to do that. So the writing here, once again, really strong in Shogun, where it's showing this absolute a-hole, what he's done, and then how immediately he flips on a dime when he realizes what he's done as well. I thought that was a really good choice to do here, because he's a horrible, horrible guy.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, the thing is, though, this whole situation comes to a head as well for Mariko and for John Blackthorne as well. You know, as you say, you know, she says, I will not give my husband my hatred, because that is what he merits. But John Blackthorne has kind of been really insistent here, and he wants her to be free of this prison, and almost insults her and the idea of using their rules. And she says, you know, you will also never be free of yourself if you're constantly trying to find freedom. And that's kind of harking back to his tale of why he wanted to be on the open ocean, in a sense.
Yeah.
It, you know, she says, it is you who are imprisoned, because you will never find freedom when you're constantly trying to look for it. You'll never be free of yourself. And so she then says, I will only be your translator from now on.
We will only speak words spoken through other people, effectively. Yeah. Yeah.
So, and I mean, it's also, you know, it's to the interesting point that in this moment, this is John Blackthorne. It's a personal thing as well. I think we have to be sort of mindful of that, in the sense that, you know, this kind of crap was happening in Europe as well.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, so it like the thing is maybe, you know, John Blackthorne being free, seeing women with agency, and he sees that that's what she should have. He can see her strength, but she is doing what she is doing, and she is happy with that, you know. And as she retorts, it's like, you also are imprisoned.
Yes.
And this is not just about me.
Absolutely.
You can't judge me for this. And yeah. I think that's really important that that kind of comes out, which it
absolutely
does.
Absolutely. And again, you know, John caused the start of there, the kickoff really from Buntaro, because he effectively requested that Buntaro treat his wife with more respect. And the minute he did that, that's when Buntaro turned and told her to tell her story to John.
Yeah.
So again, he was at the forefront of that as well. It's quite a big scene and quite a central moment of the episode. As you said, it's got comedy in it. It's got real danger in there for what's going on in this household with the return of Buntaro. I thought it was an excellently done part of the episode. Really, really good.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. No, it's really tense and really good. But I think, shall we get on to Bushido number three? Because...
Yeah, quick one here.
Yeah, because one of the other things that is happening in the village of Ajiro is... you know, they're searching. Yabushige and Omi are looking for this spy. They're still trying to search for it, but we actually now we see Toranaga going to speak with his spy down in between the rocks by the coast, close to the town or to the village, where all the pigeons are being kept hidden. And, you know, it is one of Toranaga's long-serving samurai who we find out is the spy. It is the fairly sort of genuflect kind of fisherman who first saw Blackthorn's ship.
Yeah.
But is his faithful samurai Toramato. But as Toranaga says, no, you are still to be known as Muraji, who as you know, his spy name effectively, how he's embedded into this village.
And importantly, he's telling him here that they're effectively on his trail, because they're going to put together two and two together that every time something happens that he's around. So he needs to find somebody else to take the blame, somebody else to be seen as the spy in the village.
Well, that's it. And this is where the stench of the pheasant that's causing huge consternation sort of not only within the household, but the village. It's outside of the household gates that they can smell this. And, you know, the tale has gone round of this, like, grim fest happening.
So weird, isn't it? Like, we eat aged meat quite often. Like, we eat 30-day aged beef all the time, you know. But this idea that that's not something that they would ever do in Japan, and the entire town would be affected by the stench of the rotting pheasant. Is it just that John's not good at curing meat? Is that the thing, or at aging meat? Is that the
well?
Problem
I guess so. I guess so. And it's outside. Normally, it would have to be in a dry place. And I get it rains an awful lot here.
Anjin is not a dry place.
No, it's
at all.
Not. So it might be to do with that, really. But ultimately, it ends up with John's gardener being killed because he is the one that took the pheasant, and for that he died, because of John Blackthorne's orders.
Oh.
That if anyone touches this, they die.
Yeah.
And he's kind of like in total shock around this. I love the fact that Mariko says to him, because your words have meaning.
Mm.
No, it's because John Blackthorne is like gobsmacked. He cannot believe any of this.
Yeah.
It kind of confirms to him that he just needs to get out of this situation.
Absolutely.
In some respects. And his troubles, you know, as he says to Toranaga when he's, you know, says he believes he's fulfilled his duty, you know, I'm troubled by your whole country. I want to leave and be rid of this country of Japan. And this is all spurred on by his gardener's death. And this is all ultimately used as a foil to throw the scent off the real spy by Miraji.
Yeah, absolutely. But just a small point, but it's interesting that that's in the background the whole time. They know there's a spy in the village and they're trying to find who it is, but an interesting one. We go on to Bushido number four, the biggest surprise of the episode, really. You have lots of people returning in this episode. Those should be big surprise moments, but I was absolutely unprepared after last week when we had the very small earthquake that should have been an idea that we're in for a bigger earthquake coming. But this was a shocking moment. Bushido number four, earthquake and mudslide. This is massive.
Absolutely. I mean, ultimately, Lord Toranaga could have been killed here. Mm-hmm. He was totally swept away.
Yep.
As the ground beneath him gives out, mm-hmm. From the earthquake, and he's swept away, ultimately being saved by John Blackthorne. Mm-hmm. And the second time that Blackthorne has saved Toranaga, firstly getting him out of Osaka, but then now digging him out of the ground, mm-hmm. That he's been consumed by from the mudslide. So, but I mean, what's really, I think, interesting here is that he not only saves him, but by being buried, Toranaga has lost his katanas. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have them to hand. This is, you know, a status symbol.
Absolutely.
This is a symbol of power, of a range of different things, you know, and
but like we
Blackthorne gives him his katana.
Yeah, like we
hold.
Saw how important it is, because when Blackthorne became Hatamoto, they won't let him walk around without some swords on, because that is part of the designation, part of your position.
So he gives him those mm-hmm. katanas so that Toranaga still has swords at his side and in his hands. So this was really, you can see that there was a deep meaning there. Mm-hmm. And but then it's almost quite so briefly done, because then it pulls back and you see that Toranaga's army, where it's been camping, a lot of it is currently being consumed by these mudslides.
Oh, like the second it happened, you turned around to me after the scene that happened on screen, you just kind of went, what the hell just happened there? We had to rewind it, because it's literally this massive mudslide that takes out like about half or maybe a quarter of this massive army that's just arrived in Ajiro. The army that's supposed to support Toranaga's claim and supposed to take on these armies in Osaka. And here we are in the background, this massive mudslide's coming down, just wiping them all out. And we saw how violent it is by seeing Toranaga being taken by it, so you can imagine what's going on in the distance. You know, I think it's again amazingly filmed moment in the episode. Really, really good. You know, I'm sure they were thinking about all the horrible worldwide events that have happened with these type of natural disasters. But putting it on screen at that moment when you're not really expecting, there's so much personal dynamics going on in this episode. I wasn't expecting something as massive as this, as the earth to literally shake and everybody, and to lose so many people.
Yeah,
so,
and it's one of those interesting things to do, because, I mean, you know, you get the sense of everything being quite carefully planned and crafted, certainly by Toranaga, you know, and in some cases, some quite sort of long established plans and strategies being acted out here. Mm-hmm. And yet it's the abruptness of an intervention, wholly unexpected, wholly unplanned, of a natural disaster through the earthquake and the mudslide. And, you know, now we'll see the mettle here of Toranaga and his allies, because, you know, a significant proportion of his army has probably been consumed in the mud, and he's got to try and rebound from that.
Absolutely.
And so it's really kind of that great sort of element here within the story of, you know, best laid plans, you know, can always sort of go awry.
Absolutely.
Through to something completely out of your control, like an earthquake. So I really enjoyed that element to it.
What a way to put your main character on the back foot there.
Absolutely. I think the other thing, just the little touch I really liked here, and I think this is what I really like about this show, you know, because they go back to the village, and the village has also been affected. This is obviously over a significantly large area, and the buildings have collapsed fully or partially. Mm-hmm. But I like that, you know, as they're sort of trying to deal with that mess from the earthquake back at John's household, that he honors his gardener by setting up the stones in the garden after the earthquake, and because we have that moment where the gardener tells him why he places the stones so specifically, and the sand garden and so on, and I kind of like that little touch.
Absolutely.
Certainly given, you know, maybe Mariko's words just came through to John that, well, your words have meaning. You're a Hatamoto.
Absolutely.
You have status in our world, in our culture. And if you say that, then that means something.
Yes,
and
exactly.
You've got to be careful about the words you say.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, absolutely. And it was also important as well to have John check in on Fuji and make sure she was okay. You know, again, he's part of her household and he does care and want to make sure that she's alive. He may not be wanting to pillow with her, but he is trying to take care of her, right?
Yeah.
So I thought that was important as well. How about our last Bushido for the episode, John?
Absolutely. On to Bushido number 5, the return of Lady Ochiba.
Yes. Now, we said earlier on that we were going to hold off what was happening in Osaka until we talked about this point, because the return of Lady Ochiba is a massive point. But there are other things that are going on in Osaka amongst the ruling council.
Yeah.
And it starts out with the return of the head of Jozen to Ushido. But there's an interesting element that's playing out where we have conversations among each of them about who the fifth member of of the council is going to be now that they're trying to impeach Toranaga, and they need somebody that will vote alongside them and impeach Toranaga. It can't be anybody. But I really like the conversation where you have some of the suggestions that are in there. So they're suggesting one of the lords be Akida, and the response from Ishido saying he'll smell of countryside, and then they mention Harisha, and he goes, it will smell of Christianity. And then it was Ono's cousin, Maido, and they say, well, he's syphilitic. And then they look over at Ono, who's got leprosy.
Yeah, exactly.
Go, oh, no offense kind of thing, but we don't need someone
exactly
like that. But I love that each of them are picking off all of the possible other fifth member, I guess, of the council. And then there's a really interesting piece that plays out as the episode goes on. They all eat meals together while they discuss their plans and while they discuss their machinations. And it was really interesting to see different members of the group making excuses and not appearing until eventually it's just Ishido on his own eating his food on his own. It was something that I didn't really notice the first time I watched the episode, but I guess that's what's happening. They are fracturing and separating. They aren't as unified as they were.
Absolutely. It was a really great way of just showing how this Council of Regents was beginning to fracture and become disunited, really.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it then plays into Lady Ochiba coming back because she arrives back in Osaka and it's, you know, Ishido who's pleased that she is back here. And, you know, she is the heir's mother, but it's also the way she comes back here because, you know, she fears for her son, the heir. And, you know, as she says, I'm alarmed that the council was outmaneuvered. It's a real diplomatic way, you know, she realizes that she was the heir's consort, not his wife, but consort because she bore the son, the heir. You know, so has a very special place,
exactly.
Is very important because of that. But she's also knows she's living in a world of a fully male council and the supremacy of the paternal heir, in a sense. So, you know, it's just the phrasing of it, you know, that it was outmaneuvered, that there is threats to her son, the obvious ones from Toranaga, but also she's kind of hinting at that maybe internal within Osaka from the council. And I just love the line that the time for politics has come to an end. The council will answer to me. So, I mean, it's like, oh, yes.
Hello, Ochiba. Yes, absolutely. I like this character.
Yeah, really, really good. I loved how she just does that. With Ishido as well, and he's kind of like, you know, is this the threat to him, or is she just really in this way bringing him into her council because she sees him as a point of power or the most easily manipulated? Because I think that's the wonderful character here that we have with Lady Ochiba.
Yes, I think it is. And I also wonder if she does feel there's any real threat to the heir, or Well, I guess she knows there's a threat to the air. I doubt she thinks it's from Toranaga.
No.
But I think it's, hang on a second, I'm coming back. Time for politics is over. Everybody's reporting to me. I get the power now. Even though technically she was not the wife of the Taiko, she has an opportunity here is what it feels like.
Absolutely.
And she's going to take that opportunity right now.
She can play Toranaga as the external threat, mm-hmm. and also that the council has allowed this to develop.
Absolutely.
And therefore the air is threatened.
Yeah.
You know, and something needs to be done. And exactly. I kind of really, really enjoyed that, to be honest.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Great stuff. Yeah, I'll be looking forward to seeing how it plays out there in a second. But some interesting movements there. Again, it's just intriguing to see this Council of Regents are so misaligned. You know, they have this idea of taking out Toranaga. He's over on one side going, oh God, how do I get myself out of this? How do I sort it out? It's not like he's panicking, but he must be a bit worried losing a significant part of his army to a mudslide, thinking this was going
to
be, you know, the stand they were going to have against the army from Osaka. And here they are in Osaka, all fighting amongst themselves, all unable to sit down for a meal together, let alone decide on what the actual plan for the future is. And in steps Lady Ochiba to throw another cat amongst the pigeons in Osaka. Great stuff. Oh, I absolutely love watching this show. I have no idea what's coming around the corner. Every week we turn it on, you get about halfway through the episode and I've written, you know, 2 pages of notes on the episode, and then I still have another 2 pages to write before we get to the end of the episode. So much going on, and it's so exciting. Just not knowing what's going to happen. Would you have predicted that we were going to get an earthquake and a mudslide?
No, not this. It's so rich, it's so multi-layered. Mm-hmm. It's really, really good. So yeah,
it's just the fact that they can do, you know, those small moments like Buntaro and John and Mariko and Fuji in a room and making it really, really tense. And then they can also have these massive moments, like even just the arrival of the massive army, let alone the earthquake.
I mean, for me, the show is absolutely excellent. And I think, watch the episodes a number of times, because with the subtitles, sometimes you just miss certain things. So you need to watch them through. Mm-hmm. And then you watch it through almost to be able to get the full meaning and to make sure that the notes are complete, you know, because otherwise you miss something. And each time I could just keep watching this show again and again. It's really, really epic. And at the same time, kind of quite deep and personal. And I mean, that's always great with epic, you know, whether it's movies or shows, it is that epic sweep, that grandness, mm-hmm. but at the same time, the intimate moments, the fact that these moments of greatness, that these epic moments hinge on interpersonal relationships.
Absolutely.
And the machinations that go on, you know, so it's absolutely superb.
Yeah.
Any notes, Derek, for this episode?
Nothing. I think we've talked about everything I wanted to talk about in the episode and our main Bushido points. Anything from you, John?
No, nothing from me, but I would give this 5 stinky pheasants out of 5. Just really loved this episode.
If one pheasant can stink out of 10, 5 stinky.
5 would be a disaster.
How about 5 well, freshly aged pheasants, as opposed to stinky pheasants? We don't want stinky pheasants.
We don't want stinky pheasants, but the thing I loved about the pheasant is that it was this gag, ultimately. Mm-hmm. It's about, what is the barbarian doing?
Yeah.
Why is he doing it? The consternation it causes initially with Fuji, Mariko, and the household, mm-hmm. and then into the wider village, and then ultimately ends with a real sort of sad moment, because all this stuff being lost between them, even mm-hmm. though John Blackthorne has been there for some time now, has been given the position of Hatamoto, he is still hasn't understood that position and the meaning his words, even though they were off the cuff around, if anyone touches that, they die.
Yeah.
And it was probably because it was the only way he could put it across with his, dare I say it, pigeon Japanese.
Yeah.
So it kind of ends off with this actually really sort of tragedy.
Absolutely.
Of the gardener being the one to take it and taking the rap, and at the same time being used then by Toranaga and his spy as the fall guy. I just thought it was a really great little thing going through this through this episode.
Absolutely loved it.
But let us move on to our feedback for last week's episode.
Yes, and John's back with me for feedback. The way we've been recording it the last couple of weeks, I've been on my own for feedback.
Yes.
And our wonderful fellow warriors have been keeping me company every week, John.
Excellent stuff.
Yeah.
Excellent.
So you missed out on the announcement that 9 million people watched the premiere episode.
Cool.
Which is massive. Apparently 1.8 million homes in the US tuned in that first week to watch it. So massive, massive viewership. And confirmation that we're only getting one season because the show is sticking close to the book and will end exactly the same way as the book ended, and they said they've written nothing for a second season at all. So
good to know.
So this is a big one-off show.
Yeah,
now we know it
Yeah.
Which is good, at least.
Chips all in.
Yeah, exactly.
Very good.
But let's get on to our feedback. First up, over on Facebook, we got some feedback in from Jamie Lawton, who says, again, this series still holds my undivided attention. The storyline diverges and then converges with what was written in the novel and what has been seen in the 80s TV series. The writers have managed to bring fresh interpretations to an already well-known, at least to me, tale. I'd also like to add that I am literally on the edge of my seat watching this series. There again, that could be due to my age and eyesight, as I don't want to miss anything while reading the subtitles, which, as you pointed out before, are brilliantly edited so as not to be missed by being shown on a light background, as sometimes happens on other movies or shows.
Excellent stuff, Jamie. Yeah. Yes, I mean, it is undivided attention, absolutely the right way to describe it.
Absolutely.
And I think for book readers, people who watch the 80s series, but also those coming fresh in, it really is such a brilliantly sort of woven show that just builds intrigue, tension, trepidation, you name it. It's that high stakes political gamble and maneuvering, which is just so good.
Exactly.
And just the backdrop of just a beautifully rendered Japan and all the design, the costumes, everything. Really, really good.
Yeah.
Totally agree.
Absolutely, Jamie. Yeah, I completely agree with you. It's just have no idea what's coming next, but it's interesting. Having read the book, as you have, it's interesting that they're still able to keep your attention as well. So you're not expecting what's coming next as well. Good stuff. Thanks, Jamie.
Yeah, thanks, Jamie. Victor Von Doom says, this series continues to impress. It truly belongs on the big screen. The Mafia, Cosa Nostra et al. Have nothing on what's going on in 1600s Japan.
Mm-hmm.
The beginning of Mariko and John Blackthorne's love story against the coming war is gripping. I look forward to it really hitting the fan when Toranaga returns.
Mm-hmm.
Would love to have seen Sonny Chiba, RIP, in the role of Yabushige.
That's an interesting idea, Sonny Chiba in the role of Yabushige.
Yeah.
I really only know Sonny Chiba from his Western work. He was in Kill Bill. He spoke to the bride. He played the sushi chef.
Yes.
And eventually he was the maker of her sword in Kill Bill. So I remember Sonny Chiba for that. I know he was a big action star in the 70s. I think he featured in True Romance as well, if I remember my Tarantino movies. So I haven't seen a huge amount of his movies, but that would be an interesting choice. I do love the actor playing Yabushige in Shogun, though.
Yeah, definitely.
It's one of those ones, think back to the first episode, the way we were introduced to him, he was a character who was burning someone alive to find out their last words before they died. And now, as the episodes go on, you're kind of rooting for him to navigate and survive what's going on around him, you know? So how you go from someone that will boil someone alive in the first episode to someone that you're kind of sort of rooting for by the fifth episode is really interesting. So not many actors can pull that off.
Yeah, excellent stuff. Thanks, Victor.
Thanks, Victor. Dr. Bob Phillips says, beautifully shot again, and the beauty of the shooting was certainly the main storyline here, with cannon, consort, and carnage. The baby earthquake, I think, is the very ground under their feet signalling the oncoming doom. The acting of Mariko is superb. Her tortured soul, the icy flashbacks, and the burgeoning romance. She's such an interesting character, much more so than Blackthorne at the moment.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can really see that. I mean, in some ways as well, I guess for Europeans or Westerners, John Blackthorne is that typical point of view, almost swashbuckling, you know, from that period in terms of what we already know. And I think certainly it's the two of those positions as well, and it amplifies Mariko in terms of her wisdom and everything that she has with dealing with John Blackthorne.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting three-hander really in the show. You know, John Blackthorne is obviously a central character. As you say, you meet him first, he's the first major character you meet, but it really is Mariko Toranaga and John Blackthorne's story, learning about each of those, and that the supporting characters around them. I think each episode you can kind of pick which is your favorite character, I suppose, as the show's going on, but Mariko is so interesting to watch, especially this discussion in this episode of the Eightfold Fence, and last week's episode, sorry, of the Eightfold Fence. I thought that was the most interesting insight to her as a character, because on the surface she will not let you know what's going on, but underneath she has her own plans and she has her own ideas and how she will survive this world as well. So she's fascinating. Really, really good. Thanks, Dr. Bob.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Bob. Joe Herbers says, great show, but I do have a question nitpick about the episode. Mm. I can't remember if this came up in the discussion of the last episode, but how would Mariko be able to translate Blackthorne's logbook?
Mm.
He's an Englishman piloting a Dutch ship, so he's not going to record things in Portuguese, the language of his enemies, which is what he uses to speak with Mariko. No one in Japan knows English or Dutch.
Yeah, this is an interesting one. I was having a think about this, and I was talking to Joe as well after his comment. So what happens, if you remember, Rodriguez takes the logbooks and gives them to the Portuguese, and then they get given back to Toranaga. So I feel like they've done some translation on it. She's reading some notations that are in the logbook. She's not reading the logbook directly. So they may have translated it into Portuguese potentially, or into some of the language that she, Mariko reads. I think Joe was saying that it's potentially they're written in Latin, and because she's Catholic and studying Latin, which you would at the time when you're learning how to worship in Catholicism, it all would have been in Latin. So I think they've already translated some of them. So she's getting their translation of the logbook, which in itself could be quite dangerous, because remember, again, John Blackthorne is an enemy of the Portuguese. So they may have translated it to make what he's actually doing even worse than what the logbooks are saying, maybe, you know. So potentially Mariko's reading of the books is influenced by the Portuguese, which I think is an interesting choice as well. But I don't think she's translating English. I think it is that she's getting some idea of the books from what...
Yeah, and I think it will be in Latin, absolutely.
Yeah. But an interesting idea, isn't it? Yeah, it's something that I didn't think about at the time.
No, I didn't, actually.
Yeah, so good pull there, Joe.
Yeah, excellent. Good stuff, Joe. Good spot. Thanks so much, fellow warriors, for your feedback. Great to hear your thoughts about this epic show.
Absolutely.
And keep them coming in, of course.
Yeah, I'll get John up to speed on the feedback that you've been sending in over the last couple of episodes, so he can see your wonderful thoughts. Keep sending them in. You can email us to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com with any thoughts you might have about Shogun or any of the other shows that we cover, of course. And you can join us over on a Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries. There's a spoiler post up there for each episode as it's released, and we, of course, talk about your feedback on the next episode. Back to Derek and John in the past to say goodbye for the episode. Bye.
Bye.
That's it for this episode of our chat about Shogun Chapter 5. Oh, I cannot wait for next week when we can talk about Chapter 6, John.
Yeah, absolutely. Cannot wait for the next episode. We will be back for our chat, all things Shogun, Chapter 6, Ladies of the Willow World.
Absolutely. Yes. Thanks so much for joining us. Talk to you next time.
Yeah, thank you so much, fellow warriors, for joining us. Remember, in the meantime, and until Chapter 6, keep watching and keep listening. Bye.
Bye.